not always the easiest thing to do, but I will wait on you. Oh, yes, I will trust in you. Will you raise up your hands and receive Bishop James Morton?
I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord.
Mississippi You give me
wonderful rest. I don't have to worry about these old problems.
You give me
these old burdens.
God.
Jesus is the best.
Thank you. name is great and greatly to be praised. We bless you now. And we reverence your presence.
Hallelujah. The Lord is here. The Lord is here. He has established his name. Shall reign forever. The Lord is here.
The Lord is here.
The Lord is here. He has established his name. And it shall reign forever. The Lord is here.
Father, we thank you for your presence now. Not just another emoji, but your glory.
Thank you.
have your attention. We're getting ready to begin the services. I'm going to ask that you would check your cell phones, make sure that they are cut on silence. We ask that you pray with and for this family. We're getting ready for a final view for them. I ask that you would respect their time and give them their moment, if you will. Thank you so much. But stand to your feet, let's celebrate the life of this dear soldier, Brother Charles E. Chambliss. Come on, let's celebrate his life. Or you can do better than that. Put your hands together. We have not gathered because of his death. We've gathered because of his life. Come on. Come on, we celebrate life. Come on. Put your hands together. Bless God for his life. Praise the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. At this time, we will commence with the program as the family is so present for us. I'm going to ask that if I call your name, that you would come over to the stage to my right, your left, and that way when it's time for you to give your presentation, you'll already be in place, and then once you have finished, you can go back with your family. Eric Chambliss, Joe Little Sr., Sabrina Jones, Betty Brooks, and James Dixon, if you would come over to the stage and they'll make room for you. At this time, we will have Old and New Testament scripture and invocation that will be done by Reverend Williams and Reverend Hazelhurst, and then we'll have a musical selection, then we'll have acknowledgments and resolutions by Sister Hazelhurst, and then we'll go forward in our worship. Give them a hand as they come, will you?
Amen. Our Old Testament scripture would be coming from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh, and a time to mourn, and a time to dance. God's word is already blessed.
All right, Spirit, as they come, Natalie, can you put the stream up for me? Those of you that have loved ones that would like to view the service, but they're not here, loved ones and friends, you can text them the information for the live stream. So the information is on the screen. So if you have loved ones and in days to come, you'll be able to go back to these sites and you'll be able to see the services then. All right, the choir is going to come and then we'll go forward in our worship.
Okay. morning. We have cards and acknowledgments and resolutions. Card from the Courtesy Guild. Another card from Emmanuel Baptist Church, Reverend David Cobbs, Jr., pastor. Resolution acknowledgments. The Indiana Avenue Missionary Baptist Church, Reverend Dr. John E. Roberts Way, Toledo, Ohio. The Star of Bethel Missionary Baptist Church, Reverend Timothy D. Bowles, pastor. Will Pastor Veal and the Great Big Family please rise? Resolution for Mr. Charles Chambliss. No matter what your trials are or how big your mountain seems, the Lord is there to see you through. He'll go to all extremes. So if your cross seems too hard to bear and you don't know what to do, the one who loves you most of all will be there to see you through. We're in place in this world for a limited time. And with the breath of the infant begins the race to the grave, a race everyone must run. Whereas, in the providence of God, he has brought to the close the life of Brother Charles Chambliss. On the behalf of Dr. Sedric Veal Sr., Adult Speak Seniority, Sunday School, and the entire Temple Baptist Church, we feel it's befitting to express our sympathy to the Chambliss, Harrison, Simpson, and Spivey family during the passing of your loved one. We commend you to him who knoweth best and will always do right. We have our sincere prayer. Be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to him who never makes a mistake, and remind the family to be encouraged by casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. 1 Peter 5 and 7. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution will be given to the family, and the copy will be kept in our church archives. To the family, we know your loss is deep and your sorrow is great, but we want you to know that we share in your sorrow. Humbly submitted on this 15th day of October 2022, the officers, adult with seniority, Sunday School, and the entire Temple Baptist Church, East Cleveland, Ohio, Sedric D. Veal Sr., lead service. This memorial Bible is given to the family on the behalf of the Great Big Family. Thank you.
Amen. At this time, Chanel will come.
To those who don't know me, I am Chanel, one of the many nieces of Uncle Charles, and today I am going to recite a poem that I wrote, of course dedicated to him and all of his family and friends, but most importantly his siblings. And the poem is called With a King. You'll find me again in places so simple, like nested in Dee Dee's two deep dimples. You can see me dance through Charlotte's eyes and feel my happy tears come from the sky. When you laugh and hear those fun stories and tales, I'm speaking through the voice of Cornell. But now it's time to find my place within, and I placed it in Artricia's grin. A new journey ahead for me to embark, and I felt a squeeze of courage from the hand of St. Mark. Then I sensed a calm that seemed so familiar, and I know it's from the touch of William. I know my life was full, meaningful, and substantial, and continues to flow through the passion of Nathaniel. As I took my last breath, don't wonder if it hurt, I was comforted by the prayers of my favorite Milbert. And as my soul leaves from my body, but who do I see? My beloved wife, my angel Flan. As I walk down the golden streets, strong and steady, I found my strength in the stride because of Betty. To see heaven in awe, what a great gift. That's when I heard the footsteps of Cliff. I received a medal and smiled as I was honored by no one other than good old Ronald. And as I continued on, I felt a warm welcome hug. And who do you say? It's from Dougie Doug. I felt a tap on my shoulder. Who could it be? I turned my head and there was Scoopy. Then as beautiful as the sweetest of song, I find myself back in Sarah's arms. So to all my nieces and nephews, with all your fashion labels, don't ever forget Uncle Charles could dress you under the table. And to my many friends, this isn't a goodbye and a means to an end. We will laugh once more. I'll see you again. I'm free and at rest, soaring with open wings. I lived a full life, and now I'm with the King.
All right.
Thanks, Emil.
Eric.
First, giving honor to God, who's the head of my life, pastor, family, friends. Most of you don't know me. A lot of you knew of me by name. I go by Eric Chambliss the second, but I was born Charles Everett Chambliss the second. A lot of you knew him way more than I. However, I knew him for 53 years by DNA.
All right.
To me, DNA stands for Daddy's Natural Assignment.
All right.
My father had an assignment to help bring me into this world, but his assignment was also within his DNA. I could have turned out to be horrible, terrible, in jail, dead, but here I stand to be able to see my father go home.
Amen.
I didn't call him dad, I didn't call him father, I called him Pop.
All right.
Because Pop stood for P, patience. Because he was patient with me when we finally met in 2020. He was open with me to tell me all the things that I wanted to know. He didn't hide from any questions. And the most thing that I remember him telling me that he was proud of me. My father gave me a hug and cried, and that was something that I didn't think I would ever be able to see in my entire life. I prayed and asked God, give me the words. Just give me the words that's gonna be able to express how this journey of mine has gone and came to this conclusion. He gave me Matthew 7:7-8, which is ask, seek, and knock. The passage goes as, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, it will be open. For many years, I've asked God, who is my father? Naturally, God always says, not in your time, but in his time. So I've asked and I've asked. God told me who my pop was. Then it was a matter of seeking him. I've searched, searched, and searched. And this is how funny God can be at times. I got to the point where I found his name and his spouse's name, Flonnie. And this was about 15 years ago. But I wasn't able to actually get through because God said, it's not time yet. You're not ready. He's not ready. I was like, okay. But when that time came, I knocked on the door. Aunt Charlotte was the one that opened up the door that day. He looked at me and he didn't quite know who I was or what to say, or he was just like, you look familiar. And then when the infamous name came out that most of the family knows, this is Chucky. That's when I saw my father cry for the very first time. Not tears of sorrow, despair, but tears of joy. I got a chance to see my father in an awesome light. I saw him when he was still strong and healthy, walked on his own, was able to talk, carry on sentences with no problem, answer questions like it was no tomorrow, and then talk about his siblings as if they were part of his heart. So family, I thank you for taking care of my father in my absence. Now I ask that you allow me to help fill that gap. I know it's going to be long. I know it's going to be hard, but I am here. I'm not going anywhere. And I love my family. Thank you.
Greetings to Pastor Veal, Temple Baptist Church, siblings, family, brothers of the Masons, and the sisters of the Eastern Stars. My name is Sabrina Jones, and I am the niece of Flonnie Lee Chambliss and Charles Everett Chambliss II. I remember 3 years ago speaking here at this church, but it's not as hard as it is today.
It's all right. It's okay, Sabrina. You can do it.
Uncle Charles was the first man that held me after coming out of my mom's womb on the 8th of November of 1974. He was not only my uncle, I looked to him as if my father as well. For years before my aunt Flonnie passed away, she charged me the task to assist with caring for my uncle, as she would say, my husband. My Aunt Flonnie loved Uncle Charles very dearly, to the point she executed me the task to assist him in any areas. I loved Uncle Charles.
Yes.
And he will be dearly missed, not only by myself, but by others. The last few months were very hard. And I questioned, God, how was I going to be able to do it? Working two jobs, being a single parent of a child in college. God said, I'm going to assist. You just tell me what I need to do. And if it wasn't for the help of my sister Sherry and Deborah Jones, that are they're sick and they weren't able to attend today's homegoing service, I don't know what I would have done without them. Okay. When I say that the Simpsons family came out and showed out, they came out and showed out. We were turning him during his transition, trying to feed him, trying to give him bed baths, brothers and sisters coming to pray, Masonic brothers and the sisters of the Eastern Stars praying, best friend, Brother Little, we appreciate you. And through it all, we could not have done it. We had to come together and work together. So to the caregivers, like the true caregivers, Aunt Charlotte, Aunt Betty, Aunt Artricia, Aunt Dolores, Brother Cornell, Brother William Tyrone, Brother Milbert, Brother Nate, all came together and they were there to say their last, see you later, not goodbyes, but see you later. And with the ending, I hope and pray that my job was completed and done to the satisfactory of God and my Aunt Flonnie. And I love the fact that now I have more family, the Simpsons family now. Okay. This was very hard for me. The difference between this funeral from my aunt and this one, it's the actual care and the handling of my uncle. And I'm so glad and fortunate that I was a part of it. It's so funny how he ushered me into this world. And there's a baby picture in the obituary where I'm holding on to him. And at the end, I was holding on to him while ushering him to eternal life with God. Thank you.
Reverend Veal, the Simpson family, my family that I've been a part of for over 60 years. I knew Charles way before he got to this point. I knew him before he got married. I knew him after he got married. The whole nine yards. And he always said, Joe, I don't know how you did it, but this was one of the best things that ever happened to me when I married Flonnie. I can tell you and reflect on Charles and my life together. I'd be here all day and go through a whole pot of coffee. But there's one thing I can say. Brother Charles, we drove together across this country in cars, buses, and planes. And we knew where we was going. We would get to a city, forget the name of the street, and be lost and go around a corner and he'll look up, Giuseppe. I said, what? Ain't that the church we're looking for? I said, you're right. And that's the way we travel. We travel everywhere together. If we went to a hotel, if Flighty didn't make the reservations for both of us, Pat made them. And we never did have to worry about anything. She ordered the tickets or Pat ordered the tickets. And if you knew Charles, you knew a man. If you didn't know Charles, you missed out on something in your lifetime. It's one thing I can say. He brought me a long ways in the masonry. He went from 1 to 33. I told him, that's too high for me. So I went from 1 to 32. And he tried to get me to go further, but I couldn't make it. I loved that man. And there's one thing that we used to laugh about every year. His birthday is November the 9th, 1940. My birthday is November the 16th, 1939. We used to tease each other, and he'll say, for that 1 week, guess what, bud? We the same age. Because when my birthday came, when his birthday came, it was the same as age as mine. When mine came, I was another year older. And that's the way we travel. We couldn't go anywhere without each other or doing anything without each other. I can't stand here and reflect on my life with Charles because we'll be here all day. But the family know me, and they used to tease him and get on him because he would get on them, and they would look at him and say, look, you our older brother, you ain't our daddy. But all in all, we were a couple and a pair all through life. That man, I'll tell you one thing about him, it's in the obituary. He went to culinary school to be a chef. All while he was going through this, to be a chef, he was working with a man laying carpet. And as they called it, a gopher. He would go and get anything the man wanted because he didn't know nothing about laying carpet. Finally, he had the man teach him. And once the man taught him how to lay carpet, he figured out all about being a head chef, and that was his life. He would lay carpet 24/7, 7 days a week. He loved it. And if you ever get the chance to know, you missed a man when you didn't meet that one. God bless.
Okay. morning. My name is James Dixon. Charles and I have been friends, brothers, for 40-some years of my 86 years. Charles and I have been all over the world together. I could go on for days talking about the various things about Charles. He was a very learned man. He was a little giant, well respected. Charles and I have traveled to the point of where we were so stupid that we was broke, but we have shared a bag of French fries to find out we had credit cards in our pockets. But when we saw him a couple weeks ago, they said he hadn't smiled or talked. And when we went in and started talking with him, he got to laughing and talking. But there's one trip that he always talked about. If he ever came up with the right money, he said, "Dick, I ain't gonna pack no more suitcases. Fine, ain't gonna have to pack no suitcases. I'm just gonna call ahead and have them to have my clothes at the hotel. And when I get ready to leave, they could take them. I get on the phone, get on the airplane, tell them what I need for the next trip." Well, Charles, you're finally on that trip. It's been a pleasure knowing you. It's been a pleasure letting you lead me. It's been a pleasure you praying for me when I was sick. But I love you, brother. God bless and keep you forever. One day I'll meet you again. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Betty Brooks. I have a lot of brothers and sisters. I often think about how our parents were able to deal with that many minds, that many personalities, but Mom and Dad did. Mom bore 15 children. She reached down and raised three more as little children when her brother passed away. And then she raised two of her grandchildren. I didn't know how this little lady did this, but she did. She got four class valedictorians. She had five sons who served in the military of the United States. There was no juvenile court. There was no dropping out of school. This lady had total control of all of us children. So I tried to honor my mother and my father, because I know the day that they walked into this church in 1961, and our home had burned down in Oakwood Village. And we were all on the front page of the old Cleveland Press, family of 14 children burned out. My mom had been coming to the Temple Baptist Church with her sister for that Sunday night broadcast. Then one Sunday, Pastor E.W. Ward came to our home after we were relocated here in Cleveland. And he came with Papa Hughes, Roosevelt Grimmett, Deacon Donald Boone. They stepped into our little house down on 33rd Street, and they presented my parents with a surmountable amount of money that came from the Temple Baptist Church. And he told her that the church was right up the street, because we lived off of 33rd and Cedar. And he said the church was right up the street on 75th. And I thought my mother was going to have a heart attack in the floor. 2 weeks later, she brought the entire family to the Sunday morning worship service. And Pastor Ward told the Temple Baptist Church that this was the family that had lost a home, and this was the little lady and that had all these children. And he wanted the Temple Baptist Church to enfold every one of us in their arms and be a family for this, for our family. And Temple, you have done that since 1961. At top of the Temple, Cleveland. That's why it's a lot of Simpsons. And then there was Chambliss, because my brother Charles came in with the rest of us. So you're very special to us and to our family. Some of us have, all of us have grown up now. The youngest was about 9 months when we came to Temple. And the oldest, Charles, is 81 now. So we've been a very, you've been a very positive influence on me and my family. And I love you. And I appreciate everything that you've done in support of the Chambliss and Simpson family over the years. I don't know what I would do without my church home. To my brothers and sisters, we've lost 5 of our older siblings within the last 3 years, with the exception of Lewis, that everyone around here knew him as Mr. Scoopy. But Mom and Dad raised us to be connected with Jesus. And it is my heart desire that those of you who are not, who have gotten disconnected, not lost, that you remember what our parents tried to instill in us. And Charles, being the latest, oldest living brother, Charles had that burning desire that his brothers and sisters came together and stayed together, and to remember all the precepts that our parents taught us and the love of this church family. And again, I would like to just say thank you for everyone in attendance here this morning on behalf of my family and in respect for Mr. Charles Chambliss. He was just one of my favorite 10 brothers. Okay? He was just one of the favorites. So I didn't want to say too much. I just wanted to thank you all for coming here and being a support to us, and as we can be a support to you. And thank you, Pastor Veal, for helping us walk through this. I'd like to thank Sabrina, her sister Sherry. I'd like to thank Gwen. Where's Gwen? My sister-in-law, Gwen. She's always been in step with me and Charles and Flonnie, and so many more that I won't try to start calling names. And I'd like to thank Joe, for your assistance in helping me learn about the Masons. Okay, and I just want to thank all my brothers and sisters, and I love you so very much. Thank you.
You give God a hand clap of praise one more time for the life of Brother Charles Chambliss. Come on, let's celebrate God for his life. I am definitely appreciative to know such a man and to appreciate his life and to get a chance to witness the biblical foundation that was instilled in him, and to always see him as he would pass by to give his offering. He was going to make sure that he waved at me to speak. He loved God. He loved his church. He was a supporter of me in the ministry that I was trying to do. And anytime when we were at the old temple, we needed carpet situations taken care of, he was right there to do it. And sometimes he did it for free, because it was a love and it was a ministry that he would help our church. And I just appreciate those who have talents and skills and gifts, who are so back into the ministry that will give to God, and that's a wonderful thing. And for those who work for God, I say to you, be not weary in your well-doing, for I promise you, you're going to reap if you faint not. God gave him 11 years in overtime. We are promised 70, but God decided which is equivalent to 70, but God was gracious enough to allow you to have him 11 years in overtime, and you ought to celebrate God for that. Amen. What do you say to a family that was just here in this spot? Because the rest of us, we have had occasional funerals to where at least we had some space in between. But what do you do when you have experienced what this family is experiencing now? And as I shared with them, these 22 years that I have been here, the first funeral and arrangements that I sat with them was Mother Sarah. And then to see the hand of God, how he has been moving through their family. Some have been delivered, some have had to die. But how do you get through these moments? Jiddu Krishnamurti says that one is never afraid of the unknown, but one is afraid of the known coming to an end. And most of us, we're not afraid of what we don't know, but there's a level of fear of what we know is coming to an end. So then the question is that when this is my reality, then what are my results going to be? How am I going to come out? Well, C.S. Lewis states that God whispers to us in our pleasure, but he seems to shout to us in our pain. God is still speaking even though it don't feel like it. So storms come to teach us how to trust God. Because it's rough right now. But can I tell you that God makes no mistakes? In his wisdom, he does make decisions. And in a time like this, you need to know that every now and then, God will put us in a hard place to enlighten us and encourage us, because how will you ever know what God can do unless you've been in a place to where you need God to do it? So these last few minutes that I'll be up here for, I want to talk to you just for a few minutes about learning to survive between the episode and the escape. It's in Mark chapter 5, chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. Jesus issues his disciples an invitation to come to the other side. The people that say they trust God, but they're not ready to travel. That you need to know that if you're born, you need to know that you are taking a journey. Being born and living for God is not a standstill. He keeps you moving. And I want to tell you, family, that even though it looks like death has you at a standstill now, I want to tell you, God will get you moving again. But the question is, Pastor, how do I survive with this episode? It looks like it just keeps on coming. Well, number one, family, if you're going to get through this, let me tell you hurriedly. Number one, you got to trust his quiet presence. I know that seems like it's a contradiction, his quiet presence, because I'm sure that you have lived long enough that some people who are around you, they don't have to say nothing, just their presence gives you power. Have you ever had that in your life? That now there are some people that when they come around, they make you sad, they make you mad with their presence. But it's something about just knowing the Lord is there that ought to give you a sense of peace. Am I talking to anybody in here? Listen to what he says. He says unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And then when you read on down in the verse, and when you get to verse 37, it says, and there arose a great storm of wind, the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. But look at verse 38, it says, he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. Can I suggest to you, child of God, that every now and then the Lord says, I'm not going to say nothing, but you still have my presence. And you need to know that they're not on their way to the other side by chance, but they were chosen for the other side. You need to understand that when the Lord is with you, he's not just a spectator, he's a supporter, because the truth of the matter is, if it wasn't for the presence of God, things would have been worse than what they are now. You ought to thank God that even though it seems like you can't hear his voice, he says you ought to trust the knowledge that I gave you before I gave you invitation. If you're going to get through this, you got to trust the quiet presence of God. That even though life is moving, it looks like heaven is at a standstill. But can I suggest to you, he still speaks when he's not speaking. Because in the storm, like this, you would have lost it if he had lost it. Does that make sense? If he had lost his power, then you wouldn't have the power to hold on. It got to be something, because to go through midnights and darkness and sickness and situations like this, you had to develop a level of trust that God, even though you're quiet, you could have spared lives, you could have opened doors, you could have prevented sicknesses, you could have given healing, but God, you decided another direction for our life and for our family, but God, I want you to know, we're still going to trust your quiet presence. You ain't saying nothing, but I know you're still in control, just as long as you're with me. I still believe that everything is all right. He gives them an invitation to travel. They have to trust him that God, if this is the way you want us to go, you know what's best. You know what's best. You know what's best. And I want to tell you, family, you know, you may not see it right now because of where you're sitting, but let me tell you, as I take my seat, God still knows what's best. He knows what's best. He knows what's best. But then there are times, secondly, you'll be troubled by questionable phases. Yeah. You got questions about this path that he got you on, because God, if I'm obedient, then why opposition? God, if I'm trusting you, then why do I have trouble? because there was no storm brewing on the shore. On the shore, the storm was brewing out there on the sea. God, if you had left us where we were, we wouldn't be out here in this mess. God says, don't worry about what you see. And the Bible says, and there arose, verse 37, there arose a great storm of wind. I like that, because when he talks about arose, that word is genomai in the Greek, which literally means something that happens unexpectedly to catch one off guard. And that's why I want to talk to you for a minute, because you didn't see this coming. You didn't see two funerals, two different weekends coming. No way. Even if you had prepared, you still couldn't be prepared for something like this. And I want to talk to somebody else in here. You got to confess that, Pastor, there's some storms in my life. I knew they were coming, but every now and then I had some unexpected emergencies that creeped into my life. I had my alarm system set. I had all of my windows locked. I had all of my doors locked. I got an alarm to make sure that when things are going wrong, it lets me know I got things set to where there shouldn't be no storms. But every now and then, something swooped in your life that you didn't expect. I didn't see it coming. Everybody in here, if you haven't, listen, you ought to be shouting if you haven't had that kind of experience. But for the rest of us in this room and those who are watching via social media, we have had some unforeseen interruptions in our lives, and we were troubled, and we came up with questions. God, why a phase like this? But here's the problem. God, we're fighting in this storm, and the Bible says you sleep. 100% God, 100% human. Humanity to show us he knows how we feel, but enough God to say, I'm gonna handle what you feel. Because the problem is, sometimes you can put your troubles in the hands of people that haven't been through what you've been through. So they have automatic answers. They have automatic scriptures that they have saved in their memory, that when they talk to you, it's automatic that when you're sick, God's going to heal you. But if you ain't never been sick, you don't know. I can't hear nobody here. Don't tell me what God can do if you ain't never seen him do it. You tell me what you know about him, but then if you have experience, then that's what gives weight to your explanation. And that's what's wrong with the Christian world today, is that many of us have lost the effectiveness of our witness because we don't want to go through nothing. But I want to tell you, family, when this storm is over, you're going to have a story to tell. I don't know who God is preparing you for. I don't know what God is preparing you for. But I just don't believe he allowed this unforeseen interruption to hit your life for nothing. I believe that God is up to something in your life. And when this storm is over, you're going to have a testimony like none other. Yes, you got questions now. Because every now and then, you'll have storms, these unexpected emergencies that'll catch you off guard. And then the text says, and I'm done now, the text says it wasn't just a little storm, but it was a big storm. Haven't you listened at the complaints of some people? And you're looking at them like, that's all you're going through? And you're not downplaying their storm, because they're in their shoes and they feel that their storm is great. But when you really listen at some people's complaint, it's really not a complaint at all. And the stuff that you've gone through, you wish that you can have small complaints like that. But for somebody else in here, you've had a great storm to hit your life.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And the Bible says, now the waves and the water starts moving and the ship gets full. And every now and then you'll get full. But here's the problem, child of God, if they're in water, why are they afraid? Because they're fishermen. And if they're fishermen, they've been wet before. And I'm talking to somebody in here because you have had storms before, but it's just something about this storm. Look at somebody and say, this storm, can I tell you this last minute I got, can I tell you, everybody got a this storm that will cause you to start asking questions about God, what's really going on. They start acting foreign in a familiar place. But Jesus wanted them to know that in this storm, you don't need skills, you need a savior. Huh? Here's another phase. They say he's asleep, and now that fear has gotten the best of him, text says that they wake him up, but they ask a peculiar question. They say unto him, do you care that we perish? And can I tell you, child of God, life will hit you so. Until every now and then, you'll even wonder, does the Lord care? But I may not have 100 in here that can answer, but I think I got 10 in here can answer that question about, does he care? See, I told you I had 10. I knew I didn't have 100. I knew I had 10 in here that can testify that man, hey, let me help you out. I know we're not at a regular church service, and I'm not supposed to respond like this, but man, at least let me lift my voice, because you asked a question about the God that I serve. You asked a question about the care of the God I serve. If you want to know he cares, hey, pastor, let me speak. Somebody holler, oh yes, he cares. The text says they wake him and say, Master, do you care that we perish? But here's the text. I wonder who was really asleep. I know this too much for right now, but because something in them disturbed them so until it put their faith to sleep and woke up their fear. And fear will have you asking the wrong questions. But he's so merciful, even with the wrong question, he'll give you the right answer. Well, I like that here. Did you hear what I said? Even when you don't know what question to ask, aren't you glad that he always comes up with the right answer? When you don't know what to do or how to do it, aren't you glad that he never leaves you out there to figure it out? He always leads you in the right direction. They wake him up and they say to him, man, do you care that we're about to perish? And fear has them so blinded. Now, they're so blinded until they forgot that he's in the same ship. I'm just talking about phases. Because some of you are in the same ship, but you're trying to make it feel like you're by yourself. Look at somebody beside and say, you're not alone. You may not know who they are, but tell them, you're not alone. There's somebody around you that has been through some suffering and some sickness and some sorrow and some situations. You're not by yourself. He's in the same ship, but watch this. I promise I'm done. The text says he's in the hinder part of the ship asleep on the pillow. When you look at the construction of the ship, if he's in the hinder part of the ship, that's where the pilot resides. That's the person that has the power to steer the ship. Hold on. He's already in position. Huh? He's already in position. Tell somebody beside you, he's already in position. You see, when I call you, you got to get to where I am. But when I call God, he's already there without leaving from where he was to be where I need him to be, to do what I need him to do. Anybody here got that kind of God? Anybody here serve that kind of God, that he's there when I need him the most? All right. The meter's expired. You're going through phases that you start asking questions they didn't understand. They say, man, we just want to know, do you care? Dude, we're about to perish. He says, here it is. He says, I'll tell you what. Number three, you need to trace his qualifiable performances. He says, didn't I teach y'all and train y'all and turn a crisis situation into a theater? He said, you were not absent when I took two fish and five barley loaves of bread and fed 5,000 plus. I was just qualifying who I am. When I healed the sick, I was just qualifying who I am. When I raised the dead, I was just qualifying who I am. And the only way I came up with this point is that they asked the question in verse 41. They said, what manner of man is this that even the sea and the wind obey him? I like that. He says, I'm just qualifying my performances because every time you see me do a miracle, it's just an open door to something greater. And that's what I came to tell somebody here. I feel great in the atmosphere. God is about to do something great for you. Here it is. There was a great storm, but the Bible says in verse 39, there was also a great calm. Can I tell you, God will make the wind cease. Did you hear me? God will stop the lightning from flashing. God will make the thunder hush. God will make the waves lay down like a sleeping dog. You just got to trust him. He said, when you see me do something, he says, I'm just qualifying my performance to let you know. You want to ask, what manner of man is this? You can be able to say, can't nobody do me like Jesus. I can't hear nobody in here. Can I find five of y'all in here on a Saturday morning to say, in my life, he's been doing some qualifiable performances. I know he qualified himself when I was in the sick room. He qualified himself when I couldn't do for my kids or couldn't do for my family. He qualified himself when I didn't have a house. He qualified himself when I needed a car. He qualified himself when I got sick in my body. He qualified himself when I didn't have food on the table. And my friends were at that limit. He qualified. And there was one more performance. I say there was one more performance. This temple here, I said there was one more performance. I said there was one more performance. Out on a hill. He was just qualified to die. But he said, oh no, I'm qualified to live. He said, I'm going to give this such a quality performance that I want you to know no man takes my life, but I lay it down when I get ready, and guess what? I'm going to get it up again. We got to get out of here. Listen here. He was just qualifying himself. He said, go on, do what you got to do. They nailed his hands. He didn't die yet. They riveted his feet. He didn't die yet. Placed a crown of 72 thorns on his brow. He didn't die yet. Speared him in the side. He didn't die yet. He said, I'm going to do such a quality performance. Let me stop just for a second before I talk to my daddy. Let me talk to this thief that's not warranted of mercy and grace. Let me show you what I can do. He said, what did you say? Remember you when you come into your kingdom. He said, I'm quality. You must not know about me. This day shall thou be with me in paradise.
Satan thought he could sneak into the moment and disqualify him, because temporarily there was no connection with his daddy while he was hanging on the cross. He looks up and say, "Daddy, I feel like I've been forsaken." But then he snaps himself back together and say, "I'm not gonna mess up this performance, because remember, Sunday ain't got here yet." Is there anybody here can help me go to my seat? I'm just talking about a qualifiable performance. It didn't just happen on Friday, but do I have some visitors of Sunday morning that's in this house right now? He did die, but Sunday morning, the Father raised him with all power in his hand. I can't hear nobody in here. So, good night, Brother Charles. God is doing some quality work with you right now, because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. But I got good news. What did you say? I'll tell him, Brother Charles, that there's going to be another quality performance, because the Bible says, somebody shout, the Bible says, the dead in Christ shall rise first. That's Brother Charles. But just in case we're still here, those that are alive shall be caught up to meet him in the air. So well done, my brother. Well done as a father. Well done as a friend. Well done as an uncle. Well done as a brother. Well done as a mason. Well done as a servant. Well done as a singer. Well done as a carpet layer. Well done as a chef. But most of all, you fought a good fight. You kept the faith, and you finished your course. Flunny beat you there, but on the other side, good night, my friend. I'll see you in the morning. Look at somebody, say, "Neighbor, I got good news for you. If you're in a storm right now, God's gonna do a qualifiable performance. He's gonna make your mess a miracle." Anybody here still believe in miracles? Yeah. Good night, my friend. Sleep on. Take your rest. Can't nobody stop the performance that God got for you. For what God got for you, it is for you. And God is working on some things for you. And we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God and who are the called according to his purpose. I don't care how it hurts or how you feel, God got it all in control, and he will make a way. But you got to trust him. Don't let Satan divide you spiritually. Don't turn back on God now. You got to leave out here saying, "On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand." And like Mom Betty used to say, that I may not have got a chance to do all that I wanted to do. But when you know who God is, and what he decides not to do on Monday, he might do on Tuesday. I don't know when it's going to come.
But if you get a chance to get back into bed at night, you can say, Lord, it's been a mighty good day. Now bless him like God is in control of your day. I'm done. Come on, bless him like God is in control of your day. Come on, open up your mouth and give him the fruit of your hands. Come on, act like God is in control of your day. Come on, give God praise. Give him a large praise. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continue to be in my mouth. Father, thank you for the word. Thank you for your people. Thank you for these moments of encouragement that people give eulogies, but you still give sermons, because somebody here needs to hear what you have to say. You need to hear the word. Now the seed of the word has been planted. Now allow it to manifest. Allow it to grow in somebody's heart, minds, emotions, and spirit, that they'll leave out of here mended. Leave out of here better than the way they came in. We thank you for your presence. Even though we don't understand, but you know. And it's all going to work according to your perfect plan. Give your family strength now. Let the Holy Spirit of comfort rest upon them. And the questions they have, thank you that you are the answer. The weaknesses they have, thank you that you are their strength. And you're going to give them what they need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God. Give God another praise for the life of our dear brother. We're praying for you. Our services does not end here. Family, you know I'm going to be with you through thick and thin. I appreciate you allowing Mr. Horne and myself, who are the CEOs of the House of Peace Funeral Home, to minister to you in your time of need. And we pray that everything has been done to your satisfaction. And also on behalf of Mr. Horne and myself, we want to present this memorial blanket to you, complimentary of us for you choosing us, as well as the panels that you saw. They are complimentary as well. We just want you to know we love you. We know you had many choices, but thank you for choosing the House of Peace to minister to you. We're going to keep praying for you. We're going to keep covering you. And we're going to keep asking God to bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to the cemetery. If you're going to the cemetery, listen, I'm going to ask that you immediately get in your cars, cut your lights on, cut your flashers on, and they're going to get you lined up. They're going to put a flag on your car, and we're going to go to Cleveland Memorial Gardens. Then also, the repast will be immediately following the interment at the Ken Ferguson Entertainment Center, 4071 Lee Road. So we're going to ask that you would meet the family there immediately after the service. Thank you, Temple, for being here. I look forward to seeing you on tomorrow at 10 a.m. I'll be preaching tomorrow, and I look forward to you coming. Amen. At this time, the ministers will come. Flower ladies. Only the flower ladies right now. Only the flower ladies. Thank you all so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Pallbearers, I'm going to ask that you'll line up behind Miss Sullivan in the middle aisle behind the ministers. Pallbearers, if you'll line up, I need six men. If you'll line up behind Miss Sullivan, if you'll face the door in columns of twos. Come this way in columns of twos. I need four more. Show Please stand. The family will be behind the casket. Choir, till we meet.